Ferret, I'm the director of the Smart Infrastructure Facility. I'm very happy to welcome you at the Smart Facility. A couple of new faces, that's great. And it's my pleasure and honor to welcome again George Crozer, our colleague and honorary senior fellow at the Smart Infrastructure Facility, to talk about roads, which I don't know who is working on, but it's very exciting. Let me talk about George's scientific endeavor. So Dr. Grozev is an honorary fellow here at the Smart Facility. His background in applied mathematics and physics and his research focus has been in developing integrated energy simulation and optimization models, data analytics for energy markets, and implementation network optimization algorithms. His curiosity in the applications of drones is linked to his broader interest in disruptive technologies and their impact in society. George has held research leadership position at CSIRO for more than 17 years. George has a number of projects that carried out research and development in the areas of modeling and simulation of high-performance infrastructure, agent-based modeling, energy applications, renewable energy, distributed energy resources like solar, PV, batteries, electric vehicles, and sustainable development of electricity and gas markets. In particular, and that's how we worked with each other many, many years ago, George and his team at the time developed a model called NEMSI, which was and still is the only agent-based model of the East Coast electricity grid and markets, with all the options happening between the players. A beautiful model. The only problem this model had is that obviously it was entering in competition with whatever the regulator was using at the time. So probably they were not your best friends at the time, but I still think that was one of the best models in the country. Building upon the current model in the US at the time, the NEMCAS model here by Argonne National Lab. So the beauty is that we might be able to reuse, update, upgrade the model here at Smart now, thanks to the collaboration with George. But anyway, the talk today is not about this model, it's about drones, and the floor is yours, George, for people.
Okay. Thank you very much, Pascal, for your nice introduction. I work for CSIRO in the area of modeling and simulation. As Pascal explained, we developed NEMSIM and the commercial version. We actually had a book chapter in Pascal's book about complex systems. It was 15 or 16 years ago. But you had other books as well since that time. But what's common between my latest work at CSIRO, I work actually on modeling of electric vehicles, solar PV and batteries and drones, is that all of them are disruptive technologies, and they develop quite quickly and they change many business processes. For example, electric vehicles, even though the uptake is not great yet in Australia, they're changing quite in a big way the way we use actually cars and travel with electric cars in the future. So drones are quite new technology. I mean, in military application, they started probably quite a long time, but I'm not talking about that at all. But recently, there have been many new commercial applications and many new opportunities to apply drones. So I'm not very experienced in this area. I'm very humble to talk about drones, but I thought maybe give you some broader descriptions, a little bit of physics, and a little bit of some application about infrastructure. Inspection, obviously, infrastructure modeling and simulation, and inspection is probably relevant to the Smart. Yeah. So, this is the outline of my presentation. So, I more or less indicated what I'll talk about. There will be a short introduction, a little bit about the drone technology. I'll talk about some risks. Obviously, using drones, there are some risks about people on the ground, maybe aircraft flying, so that's important to know some rules when flying drones in Australia. There are some practical things and some examples of drone application to infrastructure inspection. I'll start with those acknowledgements. I'm very pleased to visit your facility, your university here. It's a nice and sunny city. And again, thanks to Pascal about his support and invitation to talk about that area. Also, thanks to Kate, to Tim, and Linda for all of their support actually with preparing the presentation. I've spoken to a couple of people from V-Line. V-Line is the regional railway company in Victoria, and they're planning to use some drones for inspection of their infrastructure. And those conversations with those people, Donald Armstrong and Mark Lawson, helped me a little bit to structure my presentation, and Donald actually provided a little bit of feedback on my initial version. And of course, thank you to all of you attending today. So, I have my own recreational drone, which is DJI Mavic Pro. So it looks like that. It's quite small, quite compact. It's about 700 grams. And this is when it's folded. So it's quite easy to put in your backpack and go somewhere. And when it's unfolded, it looks like that. It has four propellers. So it's so-called quadrotor. If you remove the battery looks like that. The battery is quite a substantial component of the drone, and this battery can provide actually enough energy for the drone to fly up to 27 minutes. So another important component is the remote control of the drone that has a few buttons and a couple of control sticks and also antennas. You can actually use the remote control with your mobile phone. The mobile phone, there is an application that can run on the mobile phone, and you can set the parameters. You can control the drone from your mobile phone. And also there is a possibility that you can actually connect the iPad to your remote control, because it gives you a bit bigger image to watch the video, or maybe to watch the images that you are taking when flying the drone. So I try to list the most important components here on that diagram. It's not fully representative, but again, we're talking about quad rotor. So there are four propellers, and then there is an electric motor for each propeller. There is an electronic speed controller that controls the electric motors. You saw the battery, and it's in the middle. There is a start button, there is a power management board. The main component is probably the autopilot. This is a electronics and software component with a number of computing cores that actually have running a number of algorithms to stabilize the drone to perform the mission. And there is a quite good camera, 4K camera, and gimbal that stabilizes the camera when you are flying your drone. So there is a micro SD card that is used to store the images and the video. The LED indicator on the back, that's quite a big LED indicator, and a couple of other smaller indicators on the front propellers. There are forward vision sensors, a couple of them, and there are downward vision sensors as well. There are a few other sensors within the drone about inertia and other things. And of course, there is a radio receiver that receives the signal from the remote control. You can actually control the drone even in this space with a mobile phone only using Wi-Fi, and of course using GPS. The drone actually can stabilize the position quite well. You can have actually more information about some of the enabling technologies from that reference that is listed here. I mentioned about applications that are running on iPhone or other smartphones or on iPad. This is just a single screen to show you that those applications, they also integral part of the control system, and you can watch the video, you can change from video to photo images, and you can set parameters about flight altitude, distance, and calibrate the compass, and many other things. So before actually continue, I would like to explain about some main movements, and for those movements, I'll use those images of a normal aircraft. Normal aircraft with a fixed wing, they have three main movements along the three main axes. So if we look the first picture, this is the longitudinal axis, and then if the airplane is actually rotating along that axis, this movement is called rolling. So if we look the lateral axis along the wings, if the airplane is going up or down, this is called pitching. And if we actually, the airplane, the aircraft is turning left or right, and this is rotation along the vertical axis, then it's called yaw or yawing. So all of those movements are available for the drones as well. So very briefly, I would like to show you with that small animation. So that's rolling, an example of rolling. That would be pitching, coming, going up and going down, and this is along the axis, along the wings. And this is actually turning left and right, and this is watching from the top, so this is yawing. So all of those movements are available for a drone with four propellers, like quad rotor, and there is even one more which is going up and down, because remember, fixed wing aircraft, they cannot go up and down straight, but helicopters and quad rotors, they can actually move up and down. So we have four. I mean, each circle represents a propeller. So each propeller has a angle of velocity. And if this is the first and the third propeller, they have the same angle of velocity in the same direction. And the other two actually have angle of velocity in the opposite direction. This is to compensate the so-called reactive moment. Each propeller creates a reactive moment which is in the opposite direction. And I mean, you know that in the case of a simple helicopter, there is a big propeller on the top, but there is a small propeller on the tail that compensates for that reactive moment of the big propeller. So this is the reason that those two propellers, they are rotating in one direction, and the other two are rotating in the opposite direction. So for each propeller, there is a thrust force which is pointing up, and this thrust force has this that expression. I'll talk a little bit about that. So if the drone is staying at the same position, all of those thrust forces are equal to the weight. And if the forces are bigger than the weight, then it will go up, and if the forces are smaller, then it will go down, but only if all of them are equal. So I'll explain about the movement in a second. What I'd like to explain, there is a reasonably simple formula about the thrust force. So it's proportional to the disk of the propeller, also to a thrust coefficient for every propeller, and also to the air density. That's interesting, because if you have that drone at very high altitude, the density of the air there is lower, and the way that you control the drone is, I mean, you control the drone much more difficult. And also, even if you are at the same location, the same altitude, if it is hotter, the density of the air would be smaller, and then you would have a bit more difficult to control the drone, because the density is smaller, the air that actually create all of those forces is a little bit less. Again, if it is colder, then the density would be higher, and it's a bit easier to control. And then another thing here is that force, the thrust force, is proportional to the square of the voltage or the propeller motor, or the voltage that actually drives that propeller. So a little bit more is provided about the design model of quad rotors in this reference. I mean, I didn't explain that each propeller actually has a profile-like wing of the fixed-wing aircraft, and you probably know about Bernoulli effect. Bernoulli effect is responsible for keeping the aircraft and drones in the air. That effect is, I mean, if you have tall buildings, the wind between the buildings is stronger than the wind around or before the buildings, and also if you have a pipe with different diameter and there is a liquid or flow within the pipe, the speed of the flow, the speed of the flow within the narrow part of the pipe is bigger than within the wider segment of the pipe. So it's the same thing in flying aircraft, because the wing has a different profile and the air is pushing from the bottom. So I'll go to explain the movements. So when all of those speeds are the same, I'll use W1, 2, 3, and 4. You can use omega, the Greek letter as well. Then we have a thrust movement up and down, as I explained, depending on if the thrust force is bigger or smaller than the weight. Here on the top right, we have an example about row movement. So this is all along this axis. This is like forward direction for the drone. If this propeller is rotating a little bit quicker along this direction, it actually pulling this propeller up and it creates a roll movement. And pitch movement, if we have, for example, the first propeller rotating a little bit more, so then you actually pull the front of the drone a little bit higher. And if it is smaller, if this one is smaller than the other one, it will be actually in the opposite direction. And here we have an example about yaw movement, when a couple of propellers have a little bit higher speed than the other two, and then because of the active moment of the rotational reactive moment, the whole drone will start to rotate left and right. And there are a couple of other references where you can actually study those models in much more details. As I said, drone application started probably a number of years ago, and probably predominantly military application. And some of those drones are quite big, maybe several tons, 10 or 15 tons. And in that diagram, this is just one classification. There are a number of classifications based on the weight, based on the mission, based on other parameters. This is a little bit based on that paper, and it's actually just one segment of the classification that they provide there. So those two are probably big drones, even that use micro here, and they emphasize on unmanned aerial vehicle, because big drones, usually they are quite powerful, but they are still without a person actually flying with them. While those four are probably drones that appear, while if you have a quadrotor and one of the propeller or one of the motors, one of the four motors is not working, then you are losing control of that drone. So there is a bit redundancy in some of the corresponding drones that have more propellers. I'll give you some data from the specification of the two popular recreational drones. There is a company, DJI, that has a number of drones that are selling very well, that are very popular for recreational purposes. So the top one is DJI Phantom 4 Pro. There is another one, Phantom 4 Mavic Pro. We saw on the pictures Mavic Pro. And there is a new one, Mavic Air, which is smaller, which with similar characteristics that Mavic Pro. And there is a smaller one, the DJI Spark. You could see that the top speed is could reach even more than 70 kilometers per hour. This is in sports mode. And they can fly between 16 and 30 minutes, so 27 for Mavic Pro. They can fly quite significant distance for those small toys or devices, if you like, up to 10, 13 kilometers. And they have quite good cameras and quite good resolution, 4K ultra high definition resolution. This is 60 frames per second. And a little bit more about the same comparison, the same drones here, they have a quite good mechanical gimbal, usually with along all of those three axes. They're up to 20 megapixel cameras. Those are parameters for the battery. They support micro SD card, quite significant, up to 128 gigabytes. They all of them could be controlled remotely by a remote controller. This is the weight. The weight is not very big, 300, 400 grams, or maybe 1.4 kilograms. And if you like to get more information about those drones, these are the links to the corresponding specification. And this one is Mavic Air. The picture here is Mavic Air, which is only 430 grams. And I put that table about commercial drones, and again from the same company. And those three drones are Matrice 600 Pro, Matrice 200, and 100. So the first one is hexacopter with six propellers, and it's quite big, maybe more than 1.5 meters. The others are a little bit smaller. They have different battery capacity, and actually the first one has six batteries, so there is additional redundancy because you have one battery used for one electric motor and for one propeller. With payload, they can fly 32 minutes without payload. If there is 6 kilogram payload, they can fly 16 minutes, the first one. The weight is 9.5 kilograms with this type of battery. And for example, the Matrice 100, the weight is 2.4 kilograms, much smaller. Max time flying is similar, maybe 30 minutes, and again, it depends on the payload. Top speed could be even 80 kilometers, 82.8 kilometers for Matrice 200. And this can fly up to 3,000 meters. I mean, it can be operated according to this maximum service ceiling above sea level. So because, and that one can fly at altitude up to 4,500 there. That's quite substantial. This is the total weight. Maximum payload, 6 kilograms, 2 kilograms. So that gives you an opportunity to attach a special camera, thermal camera, or some other sensor to the drone and do some other activities. And you can operate that drone in negative temperatures, minus 20 for the second one. Again, you have more data in those references. We're all scared when you're using drones, and that's probably a good thing, because you can actually hit something on the ground, or potentially if there is a helicopter, or if you fly too high and there is another aircraft, there might be a collision. So there, if we talk about the risk models, there are two groups or two main hazards identified. And the first one is collision or near collision between your unmanned aerial vehicle and another aircraft. And this could be in the air, but could be also on the ground. And the second category is actually impact of the drone or its component with people or structure on the ground. So the second one is called ground risk model. And in that reference, the ground risk model is described quite well. Actually, it has six or seven additional sub-models, risk models, that, like failure model, it identifies the different probability for different components of the drone to fail. Or impact location model, because if the drone is in a given location with a flying with a given speed and maybe under given weather conditions, wind and things like that, you can calculate the area where those components of the drone itself may land if there is a failure. So you estimate the location, there is a recovery model. You may be able to recover the drone if it has some type of redundancy, and a few other models depending on the person on the ground, or depending on the building, or on the car that may be impacted by that failure. So again, I'm not going to talk too much about that, but it's important to think about those risks if you are flying a drone, even for recreational purposes. So in Australia, CASA is the main organization dealing with safety. This is Civil Aviation Safety Authority. They have quite a good website and a number of other pages that you can actually study about the rules when flying with drones for recreational purposes or even for commercial purposes. I'll briefly explain some of those rules for recreational purposes. You must not fly the drone higher than 120 meters above the ground. You must not fly your drone over or near an area affecting public safety or where there is an emergency operation going, because your drone may be actually preventing people doing the emergency. If there is a fire, bushfire, or search and rescue operations, you shouldn't interfere with the emergency operation on the ground or in the air. You must not fly your drone within 30 meters from people on land. I mean, if you have two or three people in your party controlling the drone and somebody spotting about some dangers around, the drone can fly a bit closer, but otherwise you should not allow the drone to come less than 30 meters from other people, spectators, whatever. You should fly only one drone at a time. You should not try to fly many of them at the same time, because that's quite challenging anyway. You must not fly a drone above people, and not over populous places, festivals, sporting halls, beaches, parks, and many other places, roads. So even if the drone may be 100 meters or 120 above, that creates a danger if the drone fails. You must not operate the drone in a way that creates a hazard to another aircraft, property, person, and you must not operate your drone in prohibited or restricted areas, like military bases or maybe military airports. There might be restricted areas, so you should stay away from those areas. In terms of airports or aerodromes, you shouldn't fly your drone within area of 3 nautical miles if the aerodrome is controlled. Usually it has a control tower if it's a controlled airport. This is 3 nautical miles, or 5.5 kilometers. But if it is non-controlled aerodrome or helicopter landing site, you can fly your drone closer than 5.5 kilometers. But if there is a helicopter coming, if you notice any other aircraft approaching that aerodrome, you have to very quickly and safely move your drone away from the flight path of that aircraft and try to land and not interfere with that helicopter or any other aircraft. You must only fly during the day, not during the night, and only within visual line of sight. You should not try to fly the drone behind buildings. You should not try to rely on the information coming from goggles or maybe from your device. You should always be able to see the drone directly, not obstructed by any other structure or forest or anything like that. Again, there is a reference here. Now, for licensing of commercial use, there are much more strict requirements. Again, you can look at that website from CASA. The first thing is actually to apply for aviation reference number, which is a very easy, quick procedure. Then there is a category less than 2 kilograms. If you have a small drone, you can do some commercial work without that remote pilot license, which is abbreviated like APL. And if you are serious to doing some commercial work, you need probably to get that remote pilot license, which requires about 1 week training. And it has to be done by a certified, CASA certified organization. During the training, you may get that certificate for aeronautical radio operator as well, because if you're doing commercial work, you should be able also to listen the radio or other aircraft through the radio if the airspace is non-controlled. I mean, in non-controlled airspace, a lot of activities are actually negotiated or maybe communicated through the radio, and you should be able to listen what other pilots are telling you. The multi-piloted aircraft operator certificate is required for a company or sole trader if you are doing this. So, I mean, you need as a person to have that license remote pilot license, and then you can work for a company that has that certificate. And there is a procedure, there are some requirements for the company how to do that business. Again, everything is possible, achievable, but you really need to follow the steps that are required there. Very briefly about the batteries, because the battery is quite a substantial component of the drones. And they're quite good specific energy for small weight. They can actually, and lithium polymer battery are the preferred batteries for most drones, and I think it's probably the same type for our mobile phones, iPads, and things like that. But the problem is that lithium is quite active metal, and if exposed to air, it could quite easily catch fire. So you should be quite aware about the batteries and some risks. Maybe checking the batteries on a regular basis, looking for swelling, for leakages, and for overall condition. If the battery is actually damaged or changing its shape, you shouldn't use that battery, because it's quite easy for the battery to catch fire, and it's difficult to distinguish that fire. I mean, you should check the battery life. Those batteries are usually intelligent batteries, so they have a bit of electronics providing information about the charge level, the life, the condition of the battery. You should use only approved charges, never charge the battery, never leave the batteries to be charged unattended. This is very important, do not try to puncture them again because of the fire risk. And that rule is also interesting. I didn't know until my training that if you crash your drone, I mean, the first thing is to remove the battery if you have access and if it's possible, but watch the battery for 20 minutes, because even if it looks okay, it may be internally damaged and it could potentially catch fire within 10 minutes. And people put the drone, the battery in the back of the car, and they have a fire when they are traveling, and that's quite difficult again to be distinguished. The batteries preferably should be charged in open and ventilated area, possibly on a concrete floor. And there are special rules when you actually have batteries and you travel by airplanes. Usually you have to carry small batteries that are not very powerful, like for Mavic Pro, in your carry-on luggage. You don't put the batteries in the check-in luggage. You discharge the battery. Also, you put them in a protective bags and maybe isolate the connectors a little bit if possible. So again, there's information if you have a drone and time to plan it for your trip to Tasmania or somewhere else, maybe check the requirements and the rules. There are a lot of activities, technological developments, a lot of research. This is my summary. I mean, in no way it's representative, but there are probably many research questions, and the first group of research questions are related to risk and risk reduction in drone application. I think probably that's the first thing to convince your supervisors, to convince your health and safety people that actually you can use a drone safely for a certain type of inspection. Image processing and image analytics is a big mentioned this when we were spoke very briefly this morning. Full autonomy and reprogramming the flight path, how you define the flight path for the drone. I mean, you may have structures and you may try to use some applications. There are a number of applications like drone deploy that actually can allow you to pre-program the flight path for the drone for mapping or for other purposes. I mean, swarm of drones, we can use multi-agent cooperation. I mean, that those are just several drones, just a photo, but it's probably quite challenging. Probably some of you have seen that application when at the closing evening of Olympic Games, they had many drones with indicators and doing different configurations there. It wasn't live because it was actually, they didn't have a live demo during the closing ceremony, again, maybe because of the risk, and many others. So just a few interesting areas. What are the advantages of using drones in different applications. They can provide actually high resolution images and video. So those are new digital capabilities. I mean, if we think some time ago, I mean, I actually started to do my photography with very small camera, very basic one a number of years ago, and then with SLR, and then with small basic digital cameras. But this is like a flying camera. I mean, you have your photo or video from a bird viewpoint of view. That's quite unique, but also they're quite powerful in terms of digital images and video. You can have cheap inspection and access to hard-to-reach infrastructure elements. I mean, both this is cost and access, because otherwise you have to pay for a helicopter, maybe a special structure to get there and do the proper inspection. And it's safer and quicker to use the drones than put humans in some of those difficult locations. So that this is safety and efficiency. In some cases, you can do the inspection without interrupting the process or without stopping, for example, shutting down the So this is availability and could be also having a plus for reliability. And also based on those new technologies, actually you can have new opportunities for online streaming, for more regular and more focused inspection and management activities and other things. But of course there are some challenges when you use drones. I mean, it's still difficult to remotely or manually operate drones in dynamic environment. It's difficult to operate them in all weather conditions. I mean, you can have strong wind, snow, rain, and probably you'll have quite big problems if your drone is not specially designed for those conditions. There are some autonomy restrictions and difficulties. I mentioned that question, how you put pre-programmed flight path for the drone. Payload could be, of course, for those small drones, quite small, maybe several hundred grams, maybe a couple of kilograms. And there's flight duration restrictions. I mean, you can fly 20, 30 minutes, but with those small drones, you cannot fly for very long. I mean, there is always risk of potential collision in the air or impact on the ground. And there's challenges if you try to operate the drone beyond the visual line of sight. I mean, if you try to inspect a transport corridor, which is a number of kilometers, you have to do something along beyond the visual line of sight, and that's again, you have to prepare very well. So a little bit more about those technologies is much more is given actually in that reference. So I'll be quite brief about potential applications. Those applications, my focus is again on infrastructure systems. There was a report from PwC released late last year. It's called Clarity from Above, Leveraging Drone Technology to Secure Utility Systems. So they estimate the utility that the market for drone application in utility sector, I think this is globally, is in the order of $10 billion. And I think this is again on annual basis. You can read the report from those references. I mean, it's quite generic, but still quite a good report. And they have identified several very popular areas for inspection or for using drones. It's quite good to use the drones for pre-construction, investment monitoring. I mean, you can start even before you start any project activities. You can actually survey the site and identify problems there. But it could be quite useful during the construction process because you can have those daily flights and monitoring everything that is happening on your site. Another thing is asset inventory and maintenance management. Because some of those assets, imagine electricity networks, they are very dispersed. They cover a lot of areas, a lot of kilometers. And if you are able to use some drones to identify hotspots or identify locations which require, or components of the network that require your attention, immediate attention, that would save a lot of additional inspection by people on the ground or in the air. Vegetation management, again, would be quite a good application. And another one is actually enhancing water quality by monitoring. You may monitor reservoirs or color the water in the different location and take some measures to improve the quality. So another example is actually Melbourne Water. This is on the picture. This is Thompson Reservoir. This is actually from 2009 when there was the big drought and then there was a big bushfire, the so-called Black Saturday in Victoria. So, but usually the water level should be much higher. And Melbourne Water, they actually did an assessment of the spillway structure. The spillway structure is a concrete channel, if you like, that goes over the wall. And they release a lot of water during through that channel from time to time. And you probably know the flooding in Queensland and Ivanhoe, they were releasing a lot of water. And using drones very quickly and very safely, they were able to actually check for cracking, for chipping, for shifting, for surface degradation, for weed encroachment of that spillway. I mean, you can read about that using that reference. I'm not using their copy because we shouldn't copy their photos without their permission. But that's another good example. Energy utilities. In Australia, there is an estimate that about 70 billion into the revenue from this is actually total utilities, including gas and water. About $70 billion was the revenue from all of those utilities. Probably close to $50 billion was the revenue from the electricity sector alone. So you can read about several examples how you can use drones for utilities. I probably mentioned the key benefits, but I'll mention very briefly some application areas, like identify the problematic components. You can visually you can send a drone and take photos or video, identify problematic components and address only those components. You can use thermal cameras, thermal imaging to identify hotspots and poor performance elements or maybe high temperature hotspots. To guide a rapid response after disaster and outages. After disaster, you don't necessarily know where is your outage, where the transmission line may be broken. I mean, you get other signals from the electrical systems, from SCADA and things like that. But with drone, with unmanned aerial vehicle, probably you can identify the key hotspots that you have to do the maintenance to restore the service. Inspection of hard to access areas of electricity networks. I mentioned also vegetation management. In particular, informing the hotspots and the areas that need immediate attention, and mapping and survey of construction projects. Asset inspection, offshore oil and gas, this is quite a challenging environment, even more challenging trying to put people there on those high structures. So that's another example, and you can read a little bit more using that reference. Building inspection, you can actually inspect facades, roofs, other surfaces. You can inspect for cracks and damages after an earthquake. Okay, finishing, okay, in 2 minutes. There is a reference here. There are so many applications. I mean, recently there was an information about hunting penguins in Antarctica using a drone, taking many pictures and properly counting them. And also hazard identification in disasters. This is using RFID, radio frequency identification, and drones. And if you have a railway, sometimes if there is a disaster, you have many carriages and you don't know necessarily what's in that carriage because they may be rotated and you may not have good access. access, so it may be quite dangerous. So there is a paper about that one as well. I mean, in summary, I described that emerging drone technology, which is growing exponentially with many new commercial applications, and it creates a number of new opportunities. Of course, there are many challenges for that technology, and in particular, related to risk, regulation, or lack of regulation, or human control. But there are many emerging commercial applications that are cost-effective, replacing dangerous work by humans, increasing the availability of infrastructure systems. They can provide high-quality video or images. And I mean, you can use a variety of cameras for different purpose payloads for different applications. And again, thank you very much for listening. And I'm very pleased to be able to present that seminar to you.
A bit like a crash course about drones, which is great. Questions, comments, more information? Phil.
Hi, thank you, George. That was very enlightening. Specific question about those DJI drones. Do any of those yet have the capability for pre-programmed flight paths?
Okay. I'll give you an example with drone deploy. Drone deploy is an application that gives you actually a map of a given area. So you go to this area, you may have a property, for example, rural property, and you would like to have a mapping for that rural property, and you select the corners of your area that you would like to map, and then the application will actually define the route of the drone, so it'll go like this way up and down at certain height, altitude, whatever, and then the drone will take many, many photos during that flight. All of those photos could be actually downloaded on Drone Deploy website, and then they'll stitch those photos according to the images, and they'll provide you a map for your property or for your area. And in some cases, it could be 3D. I've seen actually a 3D image from those people that I mentioned from V-Line. They did just for to explore the technology. But there is a bridge, and they fly above the bridge, under the bridge, small, maybe quite long bridge. And then you create that 3D image for the bridge and for the environment around, or maybe there is again some buildings in that rural property. You fly around those, and you can actually add additional. I mean, you can control yourself as well and collect all of those photos, and then download them to Drone Deploy that application and get your image.
Does this apply? This software applies to any kind of drones. Any kind of drone can be coupled with it.
I mean, they should be able to be controlled remotely. So that application obviously can send control signals to the drone somehow.
Yeah.
Not, but perhaps not every drone can be used, because there are some very basics and some others that are probably quite.
For that to work, generally they have to have GPS enabled so they can follow GPS.
That's a good thing. Yeah.
I've done a number of jobs. I haven't been brave enough to buy a drone yet. I've just paid other people to come and do the work for me. And in some of our coastal sites here, getting the drones to fly out over cliffs, whether it's up on top of the escarpment above trees, or whether off the edge of the coastal cliffs over the water, I'm always concerned that they're going to lose their drone. But having pre-planned flight paths where you just put the thing up, and then it goes off and does the flight and comes back and lands right next to you. Just sounds like the safest way to do it. If one of these DJI drones, smaller drones, has that capability, it might be tempted to buy one.
Probably a number of those listed have that capability.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. That is a very good comment.
Other questions, comments?
Well, they can even do more as well. the chair provides the capacity called object following. For example, you can throw it up in the air, the cycle.
Yes.
I don't follow you.
Yeah. The intelligent modes, for example, you can select an object on the screen, and then, could be a person riding his bicycle, and then the drone will follow you along that path at certain height. And I didn't mention about some of those, even didn't mention about return to home function.
Yes.
I mean, most of those drones have a return to home function that at the starting location, and if something happens, it'll return. I mean, if you lose connection or control, it's supposed to return to the same location, because but they have to have GPS enabled technology, and they have to be in GPS mode if they're in sport mode,
sure.
Maybe.
Jason.
Thanks, George. I'm even less of an expert on this than you, but I have an idea about how we might be using this in my line of work in the future. Some of what I do is flood modeling. A lot of our flood models, where we want to use 2D models, are built for LiDAR mapping. LiDAR mapping is quite expensive, particularly the post-processing. So we tend to do it infrequently, every 10 years or so. And our models become a bit of a hodgepodge as we add little bits of terrain where we know things have changed in our catchments in the interval between obtaining LiDAR data. I'm imagining in the future we're going to be able to do this with drones on a smaller scale, lower cost, more frequently. We may even be looking at picking up details that we don't currently do. We would like to include in our models, things like buildings and fences, which can influence the flow of surface water. I'm wondering what sort of challenges we're going to need to overcome. Whether I've seen a survey recently that's done with side-looking LiDAR from established a series of stations within the site. It comes out in full colour, and it's the nearest thing to a three-dimensional photograph, but it's actually vector data. It's all X, Y, Z points in three dimensions that you can build a network model out of. That sort of technology mounted on a drone, forward-looking and side-looking, what are we going to run into, do you think? Well, how far away is it? Is it going to be a privacy problem? Are drones going to be able to make a decision about, on the fly, if you pardon the pun, is that a solid object that I need to map all the sides of, or another drone needs to map all the sides of?
I think it's a good application area, because flooding happens for a certain period of time. And probably it's good to react quickly and get proper images. I mean, there are a number of issues. I mean, if that area has houses or if there is emergency going there, you shouldn't interfere with some of those things. Again, there should be a proper process and proper permission to be able to do that. But actually, you can do some of those drone deploy mapping, and you can build a 3D images and compare those images maybe over the days or maybe from 1 year to another year. And you will have all of the colors and all of the things that you could visually see there. I mean, potentially you can mount other cameras I'm not very familiar with LiDAR technology. Potentially you can develop something similar and attached to a drone. I mentioned to you about Zabidi. This is actually a technology developed at CSIRO about getting a cloud of points within a building or outside of a building. It's more or less one laser that is rotating quite easily and scanning all walls or ceiling or objects around and collecting the distance and creating those points. And then you have a bit of 3D image. So a number of other technologies potentially could be combined with that ability to fly and have quite good stability and reasonably good control, actually, because you could be in a specific point if you reprogram the drone properly. But that's one of many.
Yeah, we're already doing it reactively. We already do sort of image mapping during flight events.
Okay.
Yeah, we've had a go at that over recent years. So I'm thinking more proactive in building our maps, like building our terrain models that we use that we run the flight model over. And it's basically, if we're able to use the LiDAR technology, it it's a very fine-grained map of the entire built environment, and it can pick up stuff like changes, which is why I'm thinking privacy could potentially be an issue.
It's always
anyway, this is a few years down the track. Yeah.
It could be an issue, and there are different rules for different states or jurisdictions about privacy, what type of information could be collected. And the other thing, I mean, you potentially can get permission from those owners because they have a high risk if they live in this area. So they may give you permission to do it.
If I'm on this one, an example close to us. So we visited New South Wales Special Services almost already with Rohan. It's good to see that, you know, the state agency is investing in these new technologies. So they try to have their own capabilities rather than hiring subcontractors to that, where they slide out, but where they draw on as well. And they've got a contract with Telstra to some kind of prototype pilot project, trying to have a three-dimensional rendering of all the Telstra towers around Sydney for the moment. All New South Wales advanced stage in high definition, which means that if it can be done regularly, they would inspect, Telstra would inspect the towers just with drones. And what we were shown at the time is that they can zoom in, well, it's all visual, so at one stage, if it is in the box, of course you can't see anything, but any detail that can be visually picked, it can be picked and focused on in high definition, and that's where Telstra on one side and New South Wales Special Services on the other side see the future of this kind of technology, rather than sending a guy climbing the tower each time. Other question, comment?
Just a comment from me, it's for you, it's about the LiDAR and the drones. If you just have a look at UNSW Mining Engineering, Simit Raval, they do a lot of work particularly in coal mines and looking at the effects of upland swamps and hydrology and vegetation specifically on that. So they've got a lot of information.
UNSW
Mining Engineering, Simit Raval.
Simit Raval.
That's his name, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Final comments, questions? Or we made some.
There's also a company in Sydney called Propeller Aero. Have you heard of that? That's an American company. I think they do a lot of work with mines and agriculture, so they're continually measuring from four points as well. It's a pretty good website to look at.
There are a number of new companies in all of those areas. In agriculture, they are quite good opportunities as well. They measure the car, they collect many images, look the color of the gold or whatever, and make decisions what to do.
One, I think the thing we've discussed with Ron as well. So we've got remote sensing and high definition imagery, which is pretty, it's always there and more so in the future when the clouds of micro satellites will be on our heads all the time, which is scary. But then you've got image on demand. So especially for agricultural kind of applications, how can you merge these two and seamlessly? So your large-scale, high-definition imagery coming on a regular basis, and all of a sudden we're talking about adjustment of cattle in the outback. If you can start picking up dry season and where the best pasture is, then sending and only then sending your road, because that's a problem. You've got 20 minutes to fly past, and that's it. Whether it's automated or not, that's the limitation. And so we just send it for that purpose. But then you need to bring all these images together. That's another layer of integration.
So you're saying you can actually combine different information flows from different cameras and actually it could be part of that.
That's your view. I haven't seen any nice product from I think it's going to come soon.
Last question come in, please. One, two, three. So, thank you, George.